Hi girls, hope you are all fine. Today we'll have one more session, that is the remaining part of critical care nursing. It is principles and policies of critical care nursing. Principles of critical care nursing. First principle is the anticipation. The first principle in critical care nursing is the anticipation. And as a nurse, one has to recognize the high risk patients and anticipate the requirements, complications, and be prepared to meet any emergency condition in the intensive care unit. And unit is properly organized in which all necessary equipment and supplies are mandatory for smooth running of the unit. And it is the nurse's responsibility is that one has to arrange all the things necessary as per the needs of the patient. Next is early detection and prompt action. The prognosis of the patient depends on early detection of variation, prompt and appropriate action to prevent or combat complications. Monitoring of cardiac respiratory function is a very important factor in assessment of the patient. Then collaborative practice. Critical care, which has organized as technical subspecialty body of knowledge, has evolved into a comprehensive discipline requiring a very specialized body of knowledge for the physicians and nurses working in the critical care unit. Fosters a partnership for decision making and ensures quality and compassionate patient care. Collaborative practice is more and more warranted for critical care more than in any other field. See, as nurses, we have to collaborate with all the personnel, especially the doctors or the physicians, for providing care to the patients. And it is not appropriate if we say that we are going to provide, nurses are going to provide only nursing care. So a collaborative practice is essential in critical care unit. Next is communication. This is very, very important. Intra-professional, interdepartmental, and interpersonal communication has a significant importance in the smooth running of the unit. And collaborative practice of communication model is essential in case of intensive care unit. So you should have communication with all the professionals who are working in the intensive care unit, like within your profession and within the departments, and interpersonal communication among the members who are treating the work, providing care to the patient in the intensive care unit is also very essential. Then prevention of infections is very, very important. Nosocomial infection, it causes a lot in the healthcare services. See, this if once the patient has got any nosocomial infection, it, the cost of treating the disease is very, very more or very large. Instead of that, by just practicing aseptic techniques, we can prevent those aspects. So nosocomial infection costs a lot in the healthcare services, critically ill patients requiring intensive care are at a greater risk than other patients due to the immunocompromised state with antibiotic usage and stress, invasive lines, presence of all invasive lines, mechanical ventilators, prolonged stay in the hospital and severity of illness, and the environment of the critical unit itself highly important. So just by providing strict aseptic precautions and strict measures for the control of infections, that will reduce the nosocomial infections. Next is crisis intervention and stress reduction. Partnerships are formulated during crisis. Bonds between nurses, patients and families are stronger during hospitalization. As patient advocates, nurses assist the patient to express fear and identify their grieving pattern and provide avenues for positive coping. These are very important principles. Now let us see what are the policies of intensive care unit. What is policy? The policy is a statement, verbal, written or implied, of those principles and rules that are set by board of directors as guidelines on organization's actions. Then there should be written policies for the intensive care units or critical care units which will guide the personnel working there. The policies making body, there should be representation from administrative team, medical team and the nursing team. All the representations from all these people is very important in formulating the policies in the intensive care unit. Then what are the common types of policies in the intensive care unit or critical care unit? Admission policies. This should specify whether the patient can be admitted directly to intensive care unit or through any casualty department, just how we see in our Government General Hospital, Kurnool. And there should be policies regarding admission of medical legal cases. So there is a policy for admission of medical legal cases, that is giving intimation to the police or giving intimation to the concerned people and then admitting the cases. Next, common type of policies in critical care unit are discharge of patients policies, how the patients are being discharged from the hospital. See, there is no direct discharge from our as far as our JJH is concerned. Directly patient can't be discharged from intensive care unit. Patient has to be shifted to the concerned wards. From those wards they will be discharged, and transfer of patients from ICU to other units, medical consultation, policy for protocols for admission of drugs, equipments and procedures, administration of drugs, equipments and procedures, policy for managing the emergency situation. There is how we have a code blue in some of the hospitals, like our emergency. So in emergency situation, they will inform to code blue so that they will be coming here and providing resuscitative services. Next, common types of policies in intensive care unit are infection control policies, maintenance of records policies, payments, visiting policies. So visiting hours, as per policy of the hospital, visiting hours are there, that is 4 to 6, evening 4 p.m. to 6 p.m. as per our GGH is concerned. So like that, visiting policies also must be made. And next is the organization of intensive care unit. How this intensive care unit has to be organized? There should be a central station. A central nursing station should provide a comfortable area of sufficient size to accommodate all necessary staff functions. That is for keeping all the registers, for their provision for a desktop like that. And when an ICU is of modular design, each nursing substation should be capable of providing most, if not all, functions of the central station. And there must be adequate overhead and task lighting, and a wall mounted clock should be present for checking the time. And adequate space for computer terminals and printers is essential when automated systems are in use, and patient records should be readily accessible. Next, adequate surface space and seating for medical record charting by both physicians and nurses should be provided, and shelving, file cabinets and other storage for medical record forms must be located so that they are readily accessible by all personnel requiring their use. And also, a secretarial area may be located separately from the central station. It should be easily accessible to all the people as well. So you can see how an ideal ICU is like this. How then area, separate room or distinct area near each ICU or ICU cluster should be designed for the viewing and storage of the patient radiographs. That is, all the patient particulars must be stored there, like radiologic investigations, reports, all those things. And an illuminated viewing box or carousel of appropriate size should be present to allow for the simultaneous viewing of serial radiographs. That is, for checking the X-rays and other films, we should have a lighting service, and the bright light should also be available. Then work areas and storage. Work areas and storage for critical supplies should be located within or immediately adjacent to each intensive care unit, and there should be a separate medication area of at least 50 square feet containing a refrigerator for pharmaceuticals, a double locking safe for controlled substances, and a sink with hot and cold running water. So medication cabin should be available with a safe locking system, and all the drugs can be this will help in avoiding of misuse of drugs. And countertops must be provided for medication preparation. The cabinet should be available for the storage of medications and supplies for dilution of drugs. A separate area must be provided. So this is how an unit must be in intensive care unit, patient unit. Then reception area. This is an ideal like receiving the patient at a reception area for admission, for admitting the patient and all those things, transferring the patient. And this receptionist area. Each ICU or ICU cluster should have a receptionist area to control visitor access. Ideally, it should be located so that all visitors must pass by this area before entering. The receptionist should be linked with the ICUs by telephone or other intercommunication system. It is desirable to have visitors enter in a separate room, separate from that used by healthcare professionals. So, visitors' entrance must be different and the healthcare professionals' entrance must be different. The visitors' entrance should be securable if the need arises. Next, special procedures room. There should be provision of special procedures room. It should be located within or immediately adjacent to the intensive care unit for doing certain procedures. One special procedures room may serve several ICUs in close proximity. And consideration should be given to ease of access for patients transported from areas outside the intensive care unit. Room size should be sufficient to accommodate necessary equipment and personnel. Then monitoring capabilities, equipment, support services and safety considerations must be consistent with those provided in the intensive care unit proper. Work surfaces and storage areas must be adequate enough to maintain all necessary supplies and permit the performance of all desired procedures without the need for healthcare personnel to leave the room. Then clean and dirty utility rooms must be there separately located that have interconnection system. That without any connection between this clean and dirty rooms, utility rooms, they must be adequately temperature controlled and the air supply from the dirty utility room must be exhausted. Floors should be covered with materials without seams to facilitate cleaning. The clean utility room should be used for the storage of all clean and sterile supplies and may also be used for the storage of clean linen. Then clean shelving and cabinets for storage must be located high enough off the floor to allow easy access to the floor underneath for cleaning. The dirty utility room must contain a clinical sink and a hopper both with hot and cold mixing process. Separate covered containers must be provided for soiled linen and waste materials. And there should be designated mechanisms for the disposal of items contaminated by body substances and fluids. Special containers should be provided for the disposal of needles and other sharp objects. Then equipment storage. An area must be provided for the storage and securing of large patient care equipment items not in active use. Space should be adequate enough to provide easy access, easy location of desired equipment and easy retrieval. Grounded electrical outlets should be provided within the storage area in sufficient numbers to permit recharging of battery operated items. Then nourishment preparation area. Patient nourishment preparation area should be identified and equipped with food preparation surfaces, an ice making machine, a sink with hot and cold running water, a countertop stove and a microwave oven and a refrigerator must be available. The refrigerator should not be used for the storage of laboratory specimens. A hand washing facility should be located in or near the area. Then staff lounge. A staff lounge must be available near each ICU or ICU cluster to provide a private, comfortable and relaxing environment. Secure locker facility, showers and toilets should be present. The area should include comfortable seating and adequate nourishment storage and preparation facilities, including a refrigerator, a countertop stove, microwave, oven. The lounge must be linked to the ICU by telephone or intercommunication system, or emergency cardiac arrest alarms should be audible within the limits. And conference room. Conference room should be conveniently located for ICU physician and staff use. This room must be linked to each relevant ICU by telephone or other intercommunication system, and emergency cardiac arrest alarm should be audible in the room. The conference room may have multiple purposes, including continuing education, house staff education or multidisciplinary patient care conferences. A conference room is ideal for the storage of medical and nursing reference materials and resources, VCRs and computerized interactive and self-paced learning equipment. If the conference room is not large enough for the educational activities, the classroom should also be provided nearby for discussion of the conditions of the patients among the healthcare team members. Then visitors lounge or waiting room. Visitors lounge or waiting area should be provided near each ICU or ICU cluster. Visitor access should be controlled from the receptionist area. 1.5 to 2 seats per critical care bed are recommended, and public telephones and dining facilities must be available to visitors. Television and music should be provided. Public toilet facilities and the drinking fountain should be located within the lounge area or immediately adjacent. Warm colors, carpeting, indirect soft lighting and windows may be desirable in visitors' lounge or waiting rooms. A variety of seating including upright lounge and reclining chairs is also desirable. And educational materials and list of hospital and community-based support and resource services should be displayed in that visitors' lounge. Separate family consultation room must also be strongly recommended for counseling the family members of the patients. Next, patient transportation routes. Patients transported to and from the ICU should be transported through corridors separate from those used by the visiting public. Patient privacy should be preserved and patient transportation should be rapid and unobstructed. When elevator transport is required, an oversized keyed elevator separate from public access should be provided. Then supply and service corridors. A perimeter corridor with easy entrance and exit should be provided for supplying and servicing each exit. Removal of soiled items and waste should also be accomplished through this corridor. This helps to minimize any disruption of patient care activities and minimizes unnecessary noise. Then the corridor should be at least 8 feet in width. Doorways, openings and passages into each ICU must be a minimum of 36 inches in width to allow easy and unobstructed movement of floor equipment and supplies. Floor coverings should be chosen to withstand heavy use and allow heavy wheeled equipment to be moved without any difficulty. Next, patient modules. Ward type ICU should allow at least 225 square feet or clear floor area per bed. ICUs with individual patient modules should allow at least 250 square feet per room and provide a minimum width of 15 feet excluding ancillary spaces. Then isolation room should each contain at least 250 square feet of floor space, and each room should contain at least 20 square feet to accommodate hand washing, gowning and storage. If a toilet is provided, it must be private. Then a cardiac arrest or emergency alarm button must be present at every bedside within the ICU. The alarm should automatically sound in the hospital telecommunication center, central nursing station, ICU conference room, staff lounge and any on-call rooms. The origin of these alarms must be discernible. Space and surfaces for computer terminals and patient charting should be incorporated into the design of each patient module as indicated. Then storage must be provided for each patient's personal belongings, patient care supplies, living and toiletries, locking drawers and cabinets must be used if syringes and pharmaceuticals are stored at bedside. Separate locking system must be, drawers must be there if the syringes and any other drugs are placed at the patient bedside. Personal valuables should not be kept in the ICU, rather these should be held by hospital security until patient discharge. Every effort should be made to provide an environment that minimizes stress to patients and staff. Therefore, design should consider natural illumination and view. Then windows are an important aspect of sensory orientation, and as many rooms as possible should have windows to reinforce day and night orientation to the patients. Drapes or shades of fireproof fabric can make attractive window coverings and serve to absorb sound. Window treatments should be durable and easy to clean, and the schedule for the cleaning must be established. See that regular cleaning is possible. Next, improving sensory orientation of the patient. And additional approaches to improving sensory orientation for patients may include provision of a clock, calendar or bulletin board, pillow speaker connected to radio and television, and televisions must be out of reach of patients and operated by remote control. If possible, telephone service should be provided in each separate room. And comfort considerations should include methods for establishing privacy for the doors, shades, blinds, curtains and doors should control the patient's contact with the surroundings. A supply of portable or folding chairs should be available to allow for family visits at the bedside. Additional comfort consideration is the choice of color scheme for the room, which should promote rest and have a calming effect. Then, to provide visual interest, one or more walls within patient view may be selected for an accent, color, texture, graphic design or picture. Advice from environmental engineers and designers should be sought to de-institutionalize patient care areas as much as possible. Then utilities. Each intensive care unit must have electrical power, water, oxygen, compressed air, vacuum, lighting and environmental control systems that support the needs of the patients and critical care team under normal and emergency situations. And these must meet or exceed regulatory and accreditation agency codes and standards. Then electric supply. Grounded 110 volt electrical outlets and a 30 ampere circuit breakers should be located within a few feet of a patient's bed. 16 outlets per bed are desirable. Outlets at the mid of the head should be placed approximately 36 inches above the floor to facilitate connection. To discourage disconnection by pulling the power cord rather than the plug. Outlets at the bedside and foot of the bed should be placed close to the floor to avoid tripping over electrical cords. Then water supply. You should see that continuous water supply is available and hand washing facility is available and the zone stop walls must be installed and pipes entering each IC to allow service to be turned off should breaks occur. And the hand washing sinks deep and wide enough to prevent splashing, preferably equipped with elbow, knee, foot or sonar operated faucets must be available near the entrances to patient modules or between every two patients in watery units. Then lighting, total illuminance should not exceed 30 foot candles. It is preferable to place lighting controls on variable control dimmers located just outside of the room. And night lighting should not exceed 6 foot candles for continuous use or 19 foot candles for short periods. Separate lighting for emergencies and procedures should be located in the ceiling directly above the patient and should fully illuminate the patient with at least 150 foot candles shadow free. Patient reading light is desirable and should be mounted if possible. Then environmental control system. A maximum of 6 total air exchanges per room per hour are required, with 2 air exchanges per hour composed of outside air. For rooms having toilets, the required toilet exhaust of 75 cubic feet per minute should be composed of outside air. Central air conditioning systems and recirculated air must pass through appropriate filters. Then air conditioning and heating should be provided with an emphasis on patient comfort. And for critical care units having enclosed patient modules, the temperature should be adjustable within each module. Then computerized charting. These systems provide for paperless data management, order entry and nurse and physician charting. If and when a decision is made to utilize this technology, it is important to integrate such a system fully with all ICU activities. Bedside terminals facilitate patient management by permitting nurses and physicians to remain at the bedside during the charting process. Next, other facilities like voice intercommunication systems and presence of satellite laboratory, physician, on-call rooms, administrative offices must be attached with the intensive care unit. Okay, these are the necessary things that must be available in intensive care unit. Okay, so in next session we will see some more aspects of pertaining to intensive care unit, how that is nursing management of a patient who is critically ill. Okay, girls, bye.